salts are pulling salt water these days. And if you see burnt leaves on your trees, the edges just get crispy and brown all the time, get that water tested. You're probably blowing salt all over your fruit trees, and it's going to kill them. It accumulates in the soil, first of all. So think about that. Salt, wind exposure, I'm sorry. Plays into your cold risk. You know, if you're north and east, you need to think about a windscreen on the north and the east sides of your property. You know, something that doesn't freeze to the ground, like Suriname cherry, is a great thing. And they get quite big if you don't prune them much. So think about something like that if you're in a cold spot. Cold will determine what you can grow. You know, none of us are going to grow durians here in South Florida. But, you know, there's a lot of iffy stuff that if you're in a warm location, you can get away with. It'll change with the storm because it blows away all the leaves on everything. The next winter, the wind comes right through. So you always hope that we don't have a cold outbreak after a hurricane. It certainly worsens salt issues. Talk about that next. It's two problems. Where I live, airborne salt is a big deal. Every time the wind is from the west, I come out in the morning and I clean the salt off the windshield of my car. It gets picked up from the Gulf and Naples Bay, and it lands on top of my windshield. It's also landing on top of the leaves of all of my trees. If you're back inland, it's more likely to be soil and groundwater, like we talked about. And you need to take this into consideration. If you do have salty groundwater and you see those crisp leaves, fix it or don't plant things that are salt sensitive. You know, maybe it's not something you can mitigate. Personal taste. I have learned, when I set out to plant this place, I was going to have every fruit tree on the face of the earth, plus every flowering tree I could find. Well, 16 years after I started to plant, I ran out of room. And if I wanted to put something else in, I had to take something out. And I've been ruthless, but some people aren't. Some people just can't cut down a tree. I'm associated with the botanical garden. I pick up the phone and say, hey, this is something you need, come dig it up. But not everyone has that option. And a lot of times, you know, stuff is just not suitable for a botanical garden. So think a lot. Can you use it? If you're going to get 200 pounds of mangoes a year and all you're going to eat is 10, then it's better to cultivate a friend with a mango tree. don't grow something that's just going to rot on the ground. You know, you don't want the flies and the mess and the bugs and everything else. Is it better or cheaper than something you can buy? Grocery store produce has improved a lot over the years. You know, I used to struggle to grow pomegranates. I dearly love pomegranates. I've never eaten one in Southwest Florida that I thought came anything close to one grown in Arizona or California. Just not. My parents wouldn't even eat the ones. So I finally got up the courage and I had the guys dig that thing up, put it in the compost pile, and I've been much happier with the tree that's in there now. I don't grow grapes. They never fruited well for me. I don't grow apples, peaches, pears, plums. None of that stuff that needs winter chilling ever grew even a foot for me. So, you know, if you're in far northeast Lee, if you're out in Henry County, maybe you get enough winter chilling to make that work. Go for it. You know, grow where you're planted. Do what works for you. But I had to get rid of those things. We've got other considerations. We're going to talk about a slide at a time. So, space. I've got 2 acres. That's a lot of space. When I was 45, it didn't seem like much at all. At 61, I'm having reservations, and I had the option to buy the place next door to me, and I turned it down twice, and I am so happy that I don't have 4 acres in storage. You just will never know how happy I am. You know, when you're in the plant acquisitive state, that sounds great. And when you're in maintenance phase and you're getting a little long in the tooth, it's something to think about. Match the plant you want to grow to your best available space. Don't go get excited at a plant sale and buy something you don't know where you're going to put it and come home and stick a mango tree under a live oak. You're not going to be happy with the results. You know, think about it. Even if it's, you know, just don't get into a feeding frenzy at a sale. It's okay to write down the name of the nurseryman and go home and think about it and go pay a little more for the tree at a later date and come home once you've had a plate chance to cut something down and create a spot. That's good advice. Plan for the tree to grow. Don't say, well, I've got this space right here. This is great. I'll put, you know, put an olive tree there. We have some olives that will fruit here in Southwest Florida. You need a bright, sunny, well-drained spot with limestone soil to make olives do well. They grow in chalk around the Mediterranean. That's what makes olives happy, and they need full sun, and they cannot stand wet feet. Now, I've got lime rock. I'm good to go there. I had it in the shade. I had to have guys dig the olive tree up this year and move it. It's out in full sun now. It's the happiest thing in my whole yard. So, you know, think about your spot. Plan for growth. Plan for maintenance. We're going to talk a lot about not letting fruit trees get huge. That's, over the years, I've been preaching this. Dr. Campbell at Fairchild, if you've not had him for speaker, you need to. Richard preaches the same thing. Mangoes, you should start and plan to keep them as bushes. I'm serious. It works, but only if you plant the right variety. So we're going to talk about that. Plan before you acquire. We've already talked about that. When do you want fruit? If you go to the Great North every summer, don't plant mangoes. Don't plant lychees. Don't plant longans. All you're going to do is feed the critters and the lawn service guys. They're going to have all your fruit because you're not going to be there. Don't waste the space. Can you deal with full crop? You may dearly love one jackfruit a year, but are you going to dearly love it if you don't maintain that tree and you have 200 jackfruit a year? I don't think so. I had them falling on the ground this year because I couldn't get out there to prune the tree because I was mangled. So think about it. How much effort do you have to spend to grow this fruit? I'm lucky. I've got some help. I've got two guys that come to work every other Sunday. And it's all they can do to keep my place passable. And I'm there the rest of the time. I mean, I have to contribute most of the labor. You've got watering to do, some fertilizing. Don't pay any attention to the fruit crop fact sheets that IFAS publishes. They have never corrected the fertilizer quantities from the 1970s. And they're still telling you to put fertilizer on trees that will turn them into things that you cannot control. Fruit trees are best kept a little hungry and a little thirsty. You don't, and they fruit better if you do this and you get better quality fruit. Pruning? You gotta prune. I prune all the time. I am always walking around with pruning shears. And as I say, I'm ruthless. Go ahead.
I'm not sure. Is it cool if we ask questions during?
Yeah, that's fine with me.
Okay. We were just talking about, oh gosh.
Fertilizing.
Yes. Okay, yes. So I'm going to have to come back. I'm sorry.
I'm going to talk about it as we talk about individual fruits. I'm going to give you some hints on what you need to do for them, but in general, I do not put any solid chemical fertilizer on the ground under the fruit trees anymore. Maybe a little potassium in the spring on some big fruits like mangoes, but that's it. Nitrogen, that's a dirty word in my yard, because nitrogen makes long growths, big, long, sappy, curved growths. You ever put nitrogen fertilizer on citrus, avocados, or mangoes, you will know what I talk about. You want tight, short growth. You want a short distance between each leaf. That's called the internode. You will get much better fruit with short internodes than you will with long internodes. besides the fact that you've got to cut all that growth off every year to keep the fruit trees dead. So I use a lot of foliar fertilizer. You can put a tablespoon of Miracle-Gro in a 1 gallon sprayer with warm water and a little spreader sticker, and you can trigger a fast, short growth on lychees, mangoes, mamey, and avocados. And they run out of fertilizer, but so that they can't push out into long growth. They push out the new growth and they stop. And that's all you want. You want enough new leaves to feed the fruit next year. And that's all you want. We'll talk about pruning a little more when I show you pictures. Harvesting, it's a lot of work. You know, you let your trees get big. My neighbor was there before I moved in 16 years ago. Has an old Hayden mango in his front yard that he never would prune. He was absolutely certain he couldn't have a mango tree pruned. And that thing got to be 50 feet tall. And the mangoes were raining down on his house in his front yard. They all fell and went flat. And he was coming to me for mangoes. And I finally talked him into half-racking the tree, which he did last year, but he'd let it go too far. So, not last year, 2 years ago, he half-racked the tree. It grew out. It didn't make anything the next year. This year made a good crop, but it had grown back so much that most of them still went splat.
Okay, I have a question. Mm-hmm. What's half-racking?
Well, that's where you take a big old tree and you cut back to big wood, like that.
Oh,
like an old-fashioned hat rack or hat stand.
Oh, I get it.
And it's a temporizing measure, and I told him what he should do is cut the tree down, grind out the stump, and plant a new mango tree. He would have done much better because that's what he's going to do next spring. So, you know, you got to think about these things. You can't harvest those fruit. They're just too high up. Processing. What are you going to do with all this fruit once you get it? You've got to be thinking about this stuff. Otherwise, go buy it at the farmer's market. Don't grow stuff just to waste it. Pest burden. This is, if I gave a talk like this in 1985, we would have been talking about the pests on citrus. Because other than some fungal things on mangoes and avocados, our fruits weren't being attacked by bugs much. It wasn't a bad world. We had only had carob fly in the state for about 7 years, and it hadn't been attacking anything but Suriname cherries and guavas. And we just didn't think about it much. Here we are now, citrus is almost gone. Don't plant citrus, it's a waste of time. They're going to cut them down in 2 years anyway. So, you know, we've got a plan for bugs. Insects, croton scale, Sri Lankan weevil, a dozen different kinds of mites. They keep finding a new aphid every year. Now we've got oriental fruit fly in Homestead. Oriental fruit fly may be the death knell for fruits in Florida. It's wiped it out in Hawaii. It is an evil bug. If they can't get this under control, we're going to have problems. Other critters, squirrels, rats, possums, raccoons. Plan for it. They're awful and they're getting worse. People, fruit theft is a big deal. There's a few people in my neighborhood I would like to use for fertilizer under the bananas. I haven't done it yet, but thoughts crossed my mind. So fragility. You know, if you're back in northeastern Lee County, don't plant fragile fruits. You know, it's you're just going to come to grief. Unless you've got a big greenhouse, you're going to have problems back there. It gets really cold back in there. Northeast Collier, Hendry, Far Eastern and Northern Lee, those are real frost pockets. During the 77 freeze, there were temps down in the mid-teens back in that area. So you got to think about that. Terroir, I talk about this a lot. It's a French term. That's how they describe the totality of everything it takes to grow wine grapes. Do you have the right sun exposure? Do you have the right either slate or chalk soil? Do you have the right amount of rain? Do you have something to keep the wind off of the vines? We need to think about all of these things when we're thinking about planting fruit trees here. So that's why I'm telling you to plan before you acquire. How are you going to grow this tree once you put it in the ground? What are you going to do for it? Can you mitigate bad conditions? How much money do you have to throw at a problem? There was an old guy named Bill Whitman. Has anybody ever heard of him? Yeah, Bill was a good friend. I met Bill in 1981. He was already in his 60s. He was the grand old man of Florida fruit at that time. And Bill had buckets of money. And if he made up his mind to grow something, he threw money at it until he fruited it. But you know, are you going to build giant screen enclosures around orangutan tree? He did. You know, one time he built mist to put over the thing for the winter. And still he had his failures. You know, you can throw a lot of money, but if you just don't have the right terroir, you're not going to be able to grow this thing. What's your real interest level? How much effort are you willing to put into growing something? It's not as hard to grow a mango as it is to grow an achicharu, as it is to grow an llama or something. You need to think about that. So let's talk about some fruits here. Obviously, these are lychees. Mangoes. Okay. Of the five best fruits in the world, mangoes has to be one of the top five. Just absolutely does. And given the fact that there are more mangoes produced in the world than by pound than any other fruit, other people must agree with me. So this is a great fruit. South Florida is lucky. We've got a climate that's very much like where mangoes originated, long ago and far away. Northeastern India, Burma, Assam. We've got a climate similar to that. And mangoes are well adapted to the coastal areas of South Florida. And we brought in seeds back in the 1800s of what became all of this whole batch of mangoes that have been selected here and spread throughout the world. You go anywhere they grow mangoes, and I guarantee you somebody's growing a Florida cultivar. Whether it's thousands of acres of Tommy Atkins in Brazil, which are all destined for Europe. Just amazing, you know, seedlings of our mangoes in Australia became Kensington Bride, which is just as bad as Tommy Atkins. And I have more to say on that later, okay? See this tree? That's a 10-year-old carry. I don't let that tree get big. How many pounds do I want from a mango tree a year? I got 100 pounds of fruit off of that this year. Is that enough?
Yeah,
it is. 100 pounds of nice fruit is better than 1,500 pounds of lousy fruit. And you can see, there's the canal. So my mangoes are growing in a spot with their toes in salt water. They produce wonderful fruit. That they're easy to grow if you learn to think like a mango. This is Carrie. This Carrie's nice for shape. You look at Kit here. This is a mangy, evil-looking tree. But it bears faithfully every year, year in, year out. It doesn't care if there are hurricanes, whatever. It still carries some fruit. Kit's wonderful because it's late. You know, when you get mangoes in September and October, if the rats will let you, that's a good thing. Reliable varieties, we talked about Carrie. Carrie is a delicious mango that will never be commercial. You know why? Green. Ripens green. Just ugly. Nobody knows whether that Carrie they pick up in the grocery store is ripe or not. It's just not a good commercial variety, but for your yard, it's delicious. Kit Kit is a commercial variety. If you spray the hell out of them all summer long, they're gorgeous, and they're in the markets from Haiti much of the year because they can go up and down the mountainsides, and by elevation, they can have them fruiting at different times. So you can go to Publix and buy lousy kits, or you can grow a good kit tree here and be done with it. Graham is always going to be one of my favorites, and people argue with me about this, but Graham is a delicious mango, and because it only makes one flush of growth a year, you only have to prune it about every 4 years, and it stays nice and bushy. To Julie seedling, they're big fruits. They're easily sometimes 3 pounds. Nice flavor. The ones that mature in full sun are gorgeous, and the ones that mature on the north side of the tree are just as green as any carry. So it's, again, it's never going to be a commercial variety, but it's worth asking for. If you got room for a mid-season mango, this is a good choice. Oh, and carry is early, May to July. Kit, late August to October. Graham straddles July and August. I've seen kits or grams on the tree as late as mid-September, and they've been good for it. Rosie Gold, I wasn't going to keep this one because it was sold to me as this is the earliest mango that's reliable for it. You'll always have fruit in April. You do. You have a lousy fruit in April. They're awful. They're like Tommy Atkins. The only thing they're good for is holding down garbage cans. This year I had so many of them that I had double flushes and they fruited into July. The fruit in July are superb. They are wonderful. Nice flavor, nice size fruit. They're pretty. I can't say enough nice things about a summer ripened rosy gold. And it's a little tree. It doesn't want to get big. So this is, you know, as long as you're willing to pitch those early ones or just cut them off when they're little, force the tree to rebloom and push its fruit load into the summer, then it's a really good mango. Worth the wait. These are varieties. The first three are all Richard Campbell selections out of the Fairchild farm. Three incredibly delicious mangoes. They're going to have them in adequate numbers at the Fairchild Mango Festival next summer, so you can go buy trees. You can buy fruit too, but you're going to be able to buy trees, and those are really good. Cambodiana, on the other hand, is a very old variety that is hard to find, but like Alphonse, which is another very old variety, it's an exceptional mango, and you ought to consider looking for it. I think Gary Zill grafts a few of these every so often, and you can get them through Fruitscapes out on Pine Island, so ask Steve and Jesse. You know, they'll lean on Gary and he'll grab some more. But it's worth getting these. Trouble. The first Florida commercial variety of mangoes was Hayden. And from the 30s to the 60s, Hayden was the mango. The problem is Hayden is a big, and it does not want to be a little tree. It was a disease problem in the 50s and 60s. Anthracnose had started to attack it so badly that you had to put copper on the trees every 2 weeks. It's just not worth it anymore. And you know what? They still sell tons of this. You can still go buy a Hayden tree there at Home Depot and Lowe's. Leave them at Home Depot. That's where they belong. Kent, it's a Hayden seedling. Everything I said evil about Hayden, Kent is worse. And just about the time that the fruits start to ripen now, they are black. They are black with anthracnose, and they just fall and rot. It's one of the favorite alternate hosts of the papaya fruit fly. Don't put that tree in the ground. Palencia pride, huge mango. lots of people like it because they say, look at my mango. Here's this 6-pound mango. It's big. And it's not much better than a Tommy Nash. Now, Doc, I don't understand this mango. It's not pretty. It's got disease problems. It's a huge tree, and yet it manages to sell very well. Mine is chips in the compost pile long ago. I got fed up with that quick. And then I've been dissing Tommy Atkins all along. This is another Hayden seedling. It is a beautiful mango. If all you do is eat with your eyes, this is your mango. It is the red delicious apple of mangoes. All looks, no taste. And it's the most popular mango in Europe. And you know why? Because you can go bowling with one of these things and then ship it around the world and it will still be as edible as it will ever be. They are indestructible. That's what I have to say about mangoes today. Pineapples, I consider this a container crop. If you're in one of these cold areas back inland, you've still got enough heating days to grow beautiful pineapples. You just pull them in when it's going to be cold. You also pull them in when the raccoons are out. Because the day before you plan to harvest that pineapple, the raccoons will get it that night.
Or put an electric fence around them.
You just about have to, and over the top, too. Productivity is a problem. The taste of a perfectly ripe pineapple is just one of those things it's hard to beat, and you will never get one in the grocery store. Because pineapples do not ripen once you pick them. They are as ripe as they'll ever be. So whatever you buy at Publix, I guarantee you the people back there in Costa Rica and Honduras are eating the good ones. And they shipped us the hard little green ones. Go ahead.
For growing pineapples, is it true that it only grows one, or is it if you chop off the top of it,
yep,
and you plant it, and it'll only grow one, and then you have to chop that off and plant. I mean, how does it begin to become productive?
I'll show you right here. Okay, so this is how I grow pineapples. So these are 15-gallon pods. The mixture here is 50% commercial potting mix, and I use Fafford 4, and 50% coarse perlite. They get a couple of cups of cottonseed meal every 3 months, and I spray over the top of them with a mixture of Miracle-Gro and iron, sequestering 138. This was taken last spring. These have doubled in leaf mass since then. They are huge right now. And they're going to start flowering probably in December, and I'm going to start having fruit in June or July. When that fruit, the flower spike comes up out of the middle of it, blooms, pretty pink and purple flowers, and the hummingbirds come to those. If you like hummingbirds, pineapples are something you should plant. You'll get lots of them. And they pollinate them. So go for it. You let this thing ripen on the plant. When they start to turn golden and you can smell them, that's when the raccoons will come for them. You may want to, pick them a day earlier than you think you should. Once you snap that off, what happens is you get new growths that come up out of the base down there. They're called ratoons. And you shouldn't let more than two grow. And I try to get three crops out of one of these pots, and then I have the guys dump the whole thing in the compost pile. We start over with fresh soil, fresh plants, and we keep going. This is that one that they sell at Publix called Del Monte Gold. It's a really good one. It is smooth cayenne. You will notice that these leaves don't have any spines on them anywhere. The spiny ones are no fun to pick, and they're no fun to weed. So this is how I grow them. They don't do well for me in the soil. I've got nematodes like you wouldn't believe, and the pineapples just die. So I don't want them in the ground. I didn't want them in raised beds. I put them in artificial mix in the nursery, and that's where we take care of them. And we've watered these all summer. We've had just enough rain to keep them happy. And, you know, sometime in November, probably have to start watering them again. But they're not hard to grow if you do this. Passion fruit. This is a nice, fast crop. If you plant seeds of them in December, you can have nice vines, even if you have to grow them in pots through the winter, up and fruiting the next summer. They do have, where I am, they have to be hand pollinated. They're pollinated by carpenter bees. If you live back inland, you have enough of bees, you probably don't have to pollinate, hand pollinate. But you'll get better fruit set and you'll get more fruit per fruit or pollen if you hand pollinate. And it's real easy to do. We teach you how to do it when you come down sometime. And they'll make three crops a year. You shouldn't let them do it. It kills the vines faster. But you also should pull the vines out every third year and put in new ones. They just, it's a short-lived perennial. Don't think that the passion fruit vine that you plant is going to last the rest of your life. It's not going to. And as long as you understand that, it's not very hard to deal with. It's also a big vine.
So how do you stop them from blooming that third time?
I just don't hand pollinate because I don't have the carpenter bees. But this is 134 feet of passion fruit vine at my place. So I originally had dreams of this fruit farm being my retirement project, and I'm going to start an ice cream store. I think I'm too worn out to do this. But I've still got fruit on a grand scale. So. All of my friends get passion fruit and mangoes and a few other things. Safadilla, I just love these. This is one of my favorite breakfast fruits. And I have three varieties that manage to ripen fruit almost every month of the year. They're maybe just a hair more cold sensitive than mangoes. So, you know, if you're in a marginal area, put it on the south side of your house. This is a lotto. You can see that the guys have been scratching the fruit. I let my drove guys take fruit home because there's so much of it and they enjoy it. So I like to make them happy. So I have Roberto Perez. It's another variety that Vivian Murray used to graft. It's a really good sapodilla. You have to thin it though because it will bear so much fruit it just breaks literally every limb off the tree. And it'll happen during a thunderstorm, and there's this sad thing with all these limbs broken on the side. So I'm really thinking about cutting it down, and I don't recommend that one. Vietnamese giant is delicious. It's a great one. I don't recommend Silas Wood because it's a tiny fruit. There's more seed and peel than there is flesh. But they sell a lot of it. It tastes good, but you know, it's one bite. And you gotta work at it. Canistel, I think for the most part this is a processing fruit. I like it in ice cream, milkshakes, cream pies. It makes a nice, you know, like pumpkin brittle. You substitute canistel in the recipe. It's got a nice flavor, and I like it. Lots of B vitamins and vitamin A. This is a good for you fruit, and it's not hard to grow. It, again, is one of these things you don't want to over-fertilize it. You just get more tree. You don't get more fruit. So, and I whack them furiously after they fruit. And it doesn't make any difference. It doesn't kill them. White sapote, if you're in one of the marginal cold areas, this is your fruit. They've survived temperatures down to 22. Those and Jabotacabas both. They're good fruits. This one is one of those things that does not like wet feet, though. If you're in a wet area, you got to raise it. Plant it on a mound. There's a lot of grafted trees out there. This is a big old variety called Homestead. It's delicious. It doesn't make any pollen at all. If you don't have a pollinator for this, you will get no fruit. Something I didn't know when I planted three of them. And I had to keep driving over to the Fruit and Spice Park to find out what was actually pollinating the trees over there. Well, unfortunately, it's this runny, awful little white spotty called vermin. So now I have two vermin trees. But I like the fruit enough that it's worth this. It's worth the space to have that. And I'll just keep the vermin small. Soursop, cold sensitive. Grow it on the south side of your house if you're in a really cold area. Put frost cloth over it, put a light bulb under it, and keep it warm because they won't survive the deep freeze.
Drop the leaves at 40 degrees.
Huh?
They'll drop their leaves.
Well, they'll drop their leaves anyway. It doesn't make any difference. They're deciduous. So just go with the flow. That's an adaptive feature. That when they shed their leaves, they shed the scale and the lace bugs and things on the back sides of the leaves that are sucking the juice out of the tree. So that's a good thing in the fall. It's not a good thing in the summer. Makes great drinks, ice cream, sorbets, and makes the most incredible white jam you've ever had in your life. This is a good fruit.
Can it be grown in a container?
I think it would probably fruit about three times before it died. Once a lot of these things get root bound, I know people say they grow stuff forever in containers, but the truth is that the curve of production drops off fast and you can't recover them. Once they get that pot down, you can't like slip the root ball and plant them. They just don't come out of it. Mamay, I love this fruit. Again, it's one of my favorite breakfast fruits. I'd rather have this than any melon they sell. And I had it for breakfast this morning and I'm having it again tomorrow. And makes great ice cream pies. I make a jam with this and I add canned coconut milk. Not the sweetened stuff, but the ones the Oreo and Coke. And this is one of those flavors, combinations that was made in heaven. You know, apples and cinnamon, mushrooms and nutmeg, and mamay and coconut. They are absolutely meant to be with each other.
What varieties do you like?
This one's Pontine. I love Pontine. I like Viejo. some of the ones that Richard Campbell has introduced, like Lorito, are really good, but I'm having trouble getting decent production out of them. So if I had to say, you know, the two that will bear easily here are Pontine and Mamay, Pontine and Viejo and
Magana?
Probably Pace. Pace is a small one. It's about a Sapodilla-sized Mamay. I'm not real impressed with the size. And, you know, and there's still a big seed in there. You see, the seed's about the same no matter how big the fruit is. So if you've got a little fruit, what you've got is more seed and less pulp.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
Yeah. How big is the tree? I have one
uh-huh.
that is on a pot, and I don't know where to put it.
Well, mine, I don't let get big. This is another one you can prune and keep small.
You can top it.
I took 20 feet out of the top of one last year. It was the only one that survived Charlie and Wilma, and I didn't have the heart to cut it, because it was the only Mamay left out of 40. So I didn't prune it for a long time, and I was really worried that I was going to kill it. But I whacked it last year, and you know what? It is covered with fruit and covered with flowers.
Does it need a little sun?
Yes, full sun. Good drainage. They do well on lime rock, something you don't have to worry about.
Two quick questions. Number one, if you have a sprinkler system, like in your yard, your front yard, your backyard, how many days do you recommend putting it on and to water your trees?
Zero.
Zero?
Zero. I don't water my fruit trees unless the leaves lose their gloss.
Even after the rainy season?
If they look water stressed, I think about it for a day and then maybe I water. Otherwise, like I say, I keep them thirsty, I keep them hungry.
Okay.
I don't care if the grass dries up and blows away. It would cut the expense of mowing the grass. And I pay my guys well to mow the grass. So I don't care. And I've got sprinklers on the trees, not on the grass.
Uh-huh.
But I don't water a lot.
Okay.
I'm stingy, really stingy.
My second question, if you're looking for a good like vine for your fence,
mm-hmm.
something that grow along your fence,
no.
Is that passion fruit? Is that a good one? No.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You need to plant two. They've got to cross pollinate. So put them at, you know, two yellow. Don't plant red passion fruit. It's really sensitive to nematodes and to root rot. Just I don't care how hard the nurseryman tries to sell you possum purple or one of the red ones. Just say no, thank you. I want a yellow one and go on your way.
Okay.
And
how far do you plant them apart, the two?
25, 30 feet.
Okay.
When I say big vine, I mean big vine. And then you'll have to whack it off of the trees. It will stretch and reach for trees.
Okay.
It's what they call a liana, a big, overwhelming vine. Think kudzu from the tropics. Hey, Sarola, this is a great bush crop. They can get pretty big if you let them. I used it as a wind crop or a windscreen early on, and I'm sorry I let the root system and the plants get that big now because they're a maintenance issue, and I'm really thinking about maybe just plowing up the whole hedgerow of them and starting over with acerola in another place. But I tell you what, this is one of the best juice crops we have now. Everywhere you go in Latin America, they don't drink citrus juice, they drink acerola. And they get a lot more vitamin C, and they aren't dying of greening and canker and every other awful thing that's attacking citrus. Lychee. Somebody I read once said that lychee is a beautiful ornamental tree that occasionally makes an edible crop. I have had six lychee fruits out of six or seven trees in 16 years. If you're in the wrong spot, nothing I know of will make this tree fruit. And yet there are people in Naples that have lychees on their trees every single year. They drive me crazy, but I cultivate them as friends because it's the only way I get a lychee. And I love the fruit. I just can't make it fruit. I brought a new one in, or not a new one, it's an old one, but it's new to South Florida, Kaimana, from Hawaii. And it's a low-chill lychee. And that's my last hope. But my emperor and my Nomai Chi have a date with the chipper. Well, I mean, there's just a big tree in the way. And I keep them small, but they still get bulky.
But the tree line always was rough.
Oh, the Sri Lankan weevils love lychees long hands, just devour them. And that may be part of the problem. They may just be losing so much leaf surface. And those little weevils that you see in the leaves, their grubs are eating the root tips off. So that may be part of my problem because I have a terrible infestation. So, you know, that's probably part of it. And then you go to something like sugar apple. And as long as you put them in a dry, sunny spot, they just make fruit. They're happy. They reward you. They're ugly as sin in the winter when they're leafless. But you know what? When you get one of these on a nice, warm summer day, this is just a terrific fruit. You just twist it in half and eat it. It looks good. It's good out the seeds. I love these. This is a really pretty one, but it's white inside. But it has great flavor and no stone cells. Just, you know, I can't say enough nice things about sugar apples.
Now, do you eat the whole thing on that?
Well, you throw away the outside carpels. They aren't edible, but the inside, anything that's spoonable is edible.
And which types of those do you prefer?
They're all seedlings.
Hmm.
I'm getting ready to graft this one because it's a really pretty one and people keep asking me for it. And I've been putting them off for years, so I finally planted a bunch of seeds and I'm going to graft them next spring. It doesn't have a name. I'm not giving it one because it's just a sugar apple. Longan. As much as I like lychees, I don't understand people who like this fruit. I just don't get longan. I eat two every summer and say, yep, been there. And then Barbasolva comes down and cuts all the fruit off of the tree and takes them home, and he's perfectly happy with it. There you are. I just don't get onions, and I never will. And, you know, everybody's sense of taste is different. You know, that's why I tell you to plan on your fruits. Make sure you taste them before you waste a bunch of effort growing it. Because what if you get something you really don't like just because you got excited at a show or something, or sale? So eat this before, and there are several varieties out there. I think Kahala is the most detestable. And I think UQ is I could probably eat three of them if you forced me. But that's about the best I can say about this fruit. It fruits despite the Sri Lankan weevil. It doesn't care that the lychees down the row from it at my house don't fruit. It's much less maintenance, except it gets to be a much bigger tree. You will spend more time pruning this. Abiu.
Sorry, Berto, I didn't get your picture put into the slide.
He's got much nicer pictures. Anybody remember tapioca pudding from your childhood?
Oh, yeah.
This thing tastes like tapioca squares. It is wonderful. It's not a huge tree. You do have to have two to tango. They do not like to fruit in isolation. But if you've got a warm spot and you can keep it moist, this is one tree that actually needs some water in the winter. Because it's from Amazonia. I mean, that's a wet place. I've been there. They're delicious. You eat it with a spoon. You don't do anything but eat these fresh. And every farmer's market in Hawaii sells these 365 days a year. They fell in love with this, and they made it their own. And I know why, because it's really good. I almost forgot to put this in here, and I was going back over the slideshow last night, and I said, there's no jackfruit in here. So Jack is a huge tree. I saw one in the Rio Botanical Garden that must have been 75 feet tall and 80 feet across, and there must have been 1,000 pounds of rotting jackfruit under this tree. It was awful. You gotta prune this tree, and you start early and you prune often. After you harvest the fruit in the summer, you whack the top out of this tree. And you'll whack the same amount out every year. They really recover quickly. But you don't want 1,000 pounds of jackfruit. You want 6 or 7 good ones, and you may not have the energy to clean that many. I think it's got a lot of sticky latex. And it's a lot of work. This is a winter fruit of a Hawaiian variety called Ames Red that I really like, but unfortunately I've never been able to keep an Ames Red grafted tree alive here. They don't like to be bare-rooted and shipped. So I just have seedlings of Ames Red, some of which are decent. None of them are as dark red as this. The summer fruits, the carpels look like red lipstick. It's an amazing jackfruit. My personal favorite in this group, though, is Champanat. It's a thinner, more sausage-shaped fruit. They're about this long, and you can run a knife all the way around end to end on this thing, peel the top back, pull the stem out, and all the fruit is right there. You've cleaned a jackfruit in 15 seconds. And the flesh is soft, it's very succulent. The good ones just have wonderful flavor. It's a very, more intense version of jackfruit. Yes?
It's
Champedak.
Isn't it a little more cold?
It is a little more cold sensitive. Yeah. You will work harder to grow Champedak. It's also more sensitive to root knot nematode.
How long do you think they can be before they stop producing?
Jackfruit?
Yeah.
They can live to be 300 years old.
Oh, that old?
Yeah.
But not producing?
Oh, no, they produce. There's ancient trees in India that have been producing for that long.
Maybe ours are just not getting enough sun.
Yeah, they need full sun.
Yeah.
Are you guys tired yet? You want to hear a little bit more?
Let's go.
Okay. So ultratropicals, these are the things that the Bill Whitmans and the Bob McNaughtons, the old Rare Fruit Council International guys back in the 70s, 50s through the 80s, we're trying to grow. They went all over the world to collect this stuff. I got to go on the ends of some of those trips. It was unbelievable. Tromping through jungles in Borneo and Peru looking for this stuff. It was a lot of fun. These fruits are pandas. I'm using panda as a general term for an organism that is so highly adapted to its native environment that you can't pick it up and move it anywhere else. Pandas only live in a certain elevation range in China. They only live in bamboo forests and only certain species of bamboo, like koalas in Australia. They only can eat three species of eucalyptus leaf, and that's all they eat. They only live in certain climate regions. They're difficult to grow. If you can't change your circumstances to make these things fruit, you're going to have trouble. But they've been like the holy grail for a lot of tropical fruiters. They hate heat, they hate cold, they hate wind, they hate drought, they hate salt, and almost to a one, they're all native to red clay soil. The nearest red clay is Georgia. And Bill Whitman once thought about having truckloads of red clay hauled in for his durians. That's how crazy some people can get about these things. Rambutan, this one of the most beautiful fruits in the world. Really and truly, they're good, but they're not the taste thrill that you would think. Bill had a tree, I told you, he had to have screen enclosure around it, and blew this stuff under it on really dry, cold days. And every 5 or 6 years, he'd get one or two panicles of fruit on this tree. And now, you know, if you look carefully in the fruit section at Publix, in the end of July to the end of August, they're shipping this fruit in from Honduras. You can go buy rambutans at Publix. So save yourself the trouble and the grief that I've gone through trying to get this thing to live here. And just go pick some and eat them. They're fun. Eat them like a lychee. Same family. Soft seed, though. You know, don't chew on the seed. It's bitter. Durian. This is the king of tropical fruits. If you have not eaten a fresh durian in Borneo, you have not lived. This 25% of people think durian is the best thing they ever put in their mouth, and everybody else thinks that it tastes like something out of a barnyard. I smell things in a durian that most people don't get. It's just the most incredible fruit flavor, and the frozen ones in the Oriental markets, they don't have the mouthfeel that the fresh ones do. The fresh ones have this creamy, demulcent mouthfeel that is just unbelievable. And the whole experience of eating a durian is fantastic. And you'll keep burping durian for several days. So you get to repeat it. I couldn't figure out how to edit this picture, so you will notice that my durians are growing sideways out of the tree. They hang down. These things can weigh 7 to 10 pounds. They grow on the top of these 120-foot-tall forest giant trees in Borneo and Java and Sumatra. And I've stood up there trying to see the fruit at the top of the tree. In pouring rain with an umbrella is my only protection from the durian, because every year in Borneo, several people get killed hatching a durian tree to get their fruit. And it just splits their skull. And you can imagine, those spines are sharp and they're hard, and 7 pounds of that falling from 120 feet is a lot of fruit. It's a mace falling from a tree. Huh? Oh, I don't have one anymore. I've killed 100 of them. I think I'm over durian. The reason I don't think this will ever fruit in South Florida is because it can't take wind. You get winds of 35 miles an hour, and you just stand there in the yard, and the leaves on the durian tree are little propellers, and they just spin until they twist off and blow away. And the tree doesn't have the reserves to grow more leaves. It'll survive a couple of windy spells, and then they just die. They don't They don't die in the winter, they die in the summer. All it takes is a good downdraft from a thunderstorm and you can strip a durian of every leaf it's got. So I've given up on it. I'll go back to Borneo and get one at some point. Yes?
From what I've heard, the durian, when the tree gets older, the taste develops. Have you found that with any other types of fruit that we talked about? Would the taste change when the tree becomes more mature?
Honest to God, I've never tasted fruit from the same tree over a period of time. I have friends that grow them commercially in Hawaii, but my timing is awful. I go to Hawaii and they've just harvested the last durian and sold it. And these people, you know, they get a lot for these fruits. I mean, they can get $20 for a fruit, and the cruise ships in Kona buy everything that they can produce. So they're not going to save a fruit for me. And I seem to miss them. I've had a couple out there. They've been good, but the ones that I remember are all from Borneo and Java. And they were just absolutely worth the trip across the world to taste.
When I think the gentleman trying to say this, all the other fruits that we discussed prior to a durian, as the trees get older, do the fruits get better or different, change in taste?
No, I think it's how you harvest them. If you get them at the same stage, at any of the trees, different sizes, I don't taste anything, and I've got a pretty good palate. Mangosteen. Anyone want to tell me a prettier fruit than this one? These things are absolutely gorgeous. They have a nice flavor. Is it the best fruit in the world, as some people have claimed? I don't think so. It's good. They're hard to grow. Is it fruited in South Florida repeatedly? Do you want to waste 10 to 15 years to fruit one? No.
Is that warm? 15 years before
the fruit? Anywhere from 8 to 15. They're difficult trees. Now, I told you it wasn't a taste thrill, but it's a really good fruit. And here's the first cousin. This is a different species in the same genus. This is Achachiru from Bolivia. I've eaten this side by side with mangosteen standing in Bill Whitman's yard years ago. You can't tell them apart if you've got your eyes closed. So this fruit's easily in 3 to 4 years here. No problem. If you've got a reasonably warm location and you can keep this out of a cold wind, it will fruit here. And it'll make lots of fruit. I've had fruit all summer long, from May on. And it's re-blooming right now, so it'll have fruit in the winter. The winter ones aren't very good. You know, we don't have enough heat to make this stuff good. This is a good fruit, and it's easy to grow. And I did bring a seedling. You can put it in the plant raffle tonight. If you're in a really cold location, pass on it and let somebody who really stands a chance of growing it plant it.
Does it have the health benefits too that the mangosteen has?
All of the claimed health benefits for mangosteen are in the peel. And the peel is about the most bitter thing you've ever had in your mouth. They're awful. So, yeah, if you want to chew on mangosteen peels, it's got a lot of antioxidants, but I'm not eating.
Now this one, you can use the peel to make a juice out of it.
And I haven't tried that yet, so.
I did.
Okay.
Delicious.
Did you put it in the juicer, Bruno?
Excuse me?
Did you put it in the juicer?
Huh?
How did you juice it?
How do you juice it? Mm-hmm. You blend it with water in the blender.
The blender? Okay.
Yeah, I grow those. That's a very nice
thing. Yeah, you've got, Bruno here is a much closer resource to you than I am. He grows a lot of this stuff, and he does it very well. This is one from Berto's home country. This is Anasaboy. It's Eugenia stipitata. It gets my vote for the closest thing we will be able to grow to a citrus substitute here in coastal South Florida. This is a wonderful sour fruit. I mean, out of this world wonderful. They are fragrant, juicy. You have to work a little bit more than a lemon because the seeds are big and they're stuck in the pulp. but it makes wonderful juices, sorbets, ice cream. You can use it without sweetening on fish and other things that you would put lemon on. It's a different flavor than a lemon or a calamondin or a lime, but it's equally good. So, and this is one of those things that will fruit the pot. You can fruit this in a big pot. So if you're in a cold location and you get a seedling of this and grow it in a sunny spot, pull it in on a cold night. And you can, it'll fruit in 3 or 4 years. They just like sun and lots of water, and I use cottonseed meal on them. It's a great organic fertilizer, and it really just makes them grow nicely. Okay, so we're to the end of the talk. This is the biggest seed in the world. This is the coca de mer. Nobody would eat them because it's so endangered, it's almost extinct. You'd plant any seed that you could possibly get. That thing probably weighed 60 pounds when it was coca de mer, the double coconut. It's just literally the biggest seed in the whole world.
It's from Seychelles.
Yeah, it's from the Seychelles Island. Big fan palm. Really big. All right, I'm going to shut up. Anyone got any questions?
Yeah.
When you talked about growing pineapple, you indicated 50% potting soil, 50% perlite.
Yeah.
And then every, 3 months you give it?
Cottonseed
oil.
Cottonseed meal.
Meal.
Yeah, you can get it from, it's not sold as a fertilizer except in the camellia bulb. I knew about it because I grew camellias as a kid in Kentucky. So I knew about cottonseed meal. I bought it at the feed store, and that's where I buy it in Naples. I go to Sutherland General Store, and I call Lynn up, and she orders me 50 bags, and I put it all over 2 acres. It's about $18 a bag for 50 pounds. They feed it to cows. I mean, it can't be very expensive.
Mm-hmm. We can buy it now.
But it's an 822. Well, you have to. Sutherland keeps some in stock, but not a lot. But you've got feed dealers up here. Just find, you know, somebody that sells feed to horses. A Purina dealer will have it or can get it.
You grow coffee? Was there some information about you growing coffee plants?
Oh, I got 250 trees, but that's a whole talk in itself.
So you'll come back.
I'll come back. I'll do coffee later.
But you do have plants. What about tea? Do you have any tea plants?
No, I've killed enough tea to believe that it hates South Florida.
Okay.
Remember, it grows at modestly high elevations, 4,000 to 5,000 feet. So tea is a plant that's adapted to mist forest conditions. There's always clouds. Temperatures during the day are probably in the upper 60s. Nights are in the 50s. We only have that temperature range here in January and February, and that's our driest months of the year. And these things die in the summer. You get them through the winter, and the heat hits, and they just crumble. And it's strange because I have a lot of camellias, it's Camellia sinensis, that do just fine here, but not tea. I can't keep it alive.
How about a Mammae Americana?
I've got several of them. It's a wonderful fruit. It is a little cold sensitive. It's a big tree, and it doesn't respond really well to Peridot. But there's an old variety here called Martin that is really good. Richard Campbell has introduced one called Campos Azules that is even bigger. I mean, Martin's like this, so they're a little bigger than a softball. Campos Azules are the size of a good-sized melon. This fruit tastes like the best dried apricot you've ever had, only it's got a little bit juicy, nicer mouthfeel than apricots have. And in Brazil, they call them abacate de pará, right? Which is apricot of pará, which is the Amazonian state. So it is ultra tropical, but it does grow here, and it's fruits most years here.
I was thinking about getting this magazine, Florida Agriculture, like a subscription to it.
Uh-huh.
I was wondering, if not that, do you have any sort of recommendation that keeps you up to learning about them?
I do it all off the internet. There used to be a couple of good tropical fruit publications. The Australians produce most of the really good published literature now, and I can give you the name of the guy that publishes their stuff. There's probably a way to have it sent over. He does most of it as annuals, but it's a nice full-color magazine full of all kinds of information about tropical fruits. They do a beautiful job. They're much more intense gardeners and small-level horticulturists than we are. A lot along the lines of British gardeners. We just don't compare to them. We don't have that kind of intensity and dedication. Anybody else?
Do you have anything to say about the Encomido star apple?
Nothing we say in polite company. It's a poor obby.
Okay.
I mean, if you're going to waste space on a difficult tropical tree, and if you're in a cold location, it's a difficult tropical tree, get an obby. Don't get a cop.
Get two obbys.
Yeah, get two obbys. But two obbys will be smaller still than one Caimito tree. Caimito has always been one of my indicator trees. When I'm looking at an area to see what kind of fruit trees you can grow by how cold it gets there, if you can't grow a Caimito, you can't grow most of the tropicals. They're very cold sensitive. And when I bought my place back in 1999, I drove down the street and I got to that neighbor that had the giant mango. His mango wasn't that big then. I looked in the backyard and there's a 40-foot tall Caimito with fruit hanging everywhere. And I said, oh, I found my home. So it's a great indicator tree. It will tell you, because if you get to 32 degrees, that tree will freeze to the ground. And it will not come back. You can start over.
My tree never gives any fruit, ever.
Is it grafted or a seedling?
I have no idea.
Probably a seedling. Some of them just don't.
Yeah, just don't.
It's not my favorite fruit. Anybody else?
What about Adamoya?
I love them. Geffner is probably still the best bet for South Florida. The one they sell the most of now is a pink one called Lisa, but they do not set much fruit at all without hand pollination, and they really have to get pretty big before they'll set any kind of a crop at all. Geffner, on the other hand, sets good crops. They aren't very big fruit, but they're delicious. And to go one step further, the parent cherimoya, you know, Adamoya is a cross between the cherimoya, a highland anona from Peru, and the sugar apple, which is a lowland Caribbean fruit. Cherimoya is Dalton fruit here. And I know that people claim that the drink of cherimoya is cherimoya. It's an Adamoya. I know that's where it came from, because it's got leaves like an Adamoya. Anybody else?
I have two soursop trees, I think, in a 15 and 20-gallon container, and they're on my lanai. And I was thinking about putting them in the ground. Would you suggest I put them on the, in the containers?
How cold are you?
And I'm in Lehigh, so it's a good one. Yeah, I know.
I'd put them in 35-gallon pots and prune them this winter, but slit the root ball before they get really pot-bound, or they'll just tie themselves in a knot. Yeah, it's a great fruit. I love them, but they're just really hard in a cold area.
What about custard apple?
Most of them taste like library paste.
Which one?
Custard apple.
Custard apple?
Yeah. It's one of my holy grails. Back in the mid-80s, I met these people down in the South Naples, down in the high-end, high-rent district where I did not live, who had a giant custard apple tree that made a couple of hundred gigantic, bright yellow fruit every spring, and they were delicious. They were sweet, there were no stone cells, and they were much older than I am now, and they couldn't handle the volume of fruit, and they had somebody come in and cut the tree down before anybody propagated it. But people got some seeds, and if anybody ever hears of somebody with a great big yellow, creamy, sweet custard apple, I want to graft that tree. Okay, so they were here, they don't seem to be now. And all those ones that Zill sells from Honduras, the yellow ones like Tikal, or the red ones like Tikal and some of the others, they taste like library paste. Gary likes red fruit. He's a good friend. I like Gary. But Gary eats with his eyes. He does not eat with his mouth. You can tell when you're eating fruit with some people that all that they are eating is what they see. Their sense of taste isn't very developed. So if it's gorgeous, those are the people that you sell orangutans to.
What about green sapote? Like mamey, similar to mamey?
I would rather have a mamey.
Okay.
They're out in Hawaii, they've got some wonderful green sapote. One of them tastes like a Pontine mamey with Hershey's syrup on it. But I can't get them to keep leaves on them here. It's too warm. It's a high elevation plant.
And black sapote?
Tastes like something I stepped in once.
What the Ross sapote?
I would rather plant a much better Canistel. Ross sapote doesn't ripen until it drops. The skin splits and they're full of sour buds. It's a way to get added protein in your diet, but it's not going to be protein in my diet. I don't have strong opinions, but.
Do you have any white sapotes that you would recommend besides the Homestead?
Homestead, Dane, red ones are all terrific.
Thank you.
People used to bring in a bunch of them from California, like Subel and stuff, but they never fruited well here. You're much better off getting a seed from any white sapote. Grow a good rootstock and go to the Fruit and Spice Park or my place and get bugwood. And
from
grow
the Redmond ones?
Huh?
From the Dayton and the Redmonds?
Or Homestead. I've got three Homesteads. I mean, I've got lots of bugwood. And Homestead's a big fruit, and it's something you let it get perfectly ripe. You split it around the middle and just twist, and you eat it with a spoon. They are fantastic.
Do you recommend, with the Spanish lime, do you recommend grafting those, or are they fine usually from seed?
Spanish lime?
The Gannets or normal?
Yes, you should graft it. Queen is a good one. There's some others from out of Puerto Rico now. You do have to have a male and a female. It's a big tree. They're very cold sensitive. And I think they taste like an underripe persimmon.
About Langsat or Dooku?
Oh, it's like a grapefruit flavored gumdrop. This is one of the best fruits in the world.
What is it?
Langsat. It's a fruit native to the Philippines and Borneo. It's in the mahogany family. And you peel it like a lychee. It's got kind of a leathery yellow skin. And then it's got these four or five translucent sections you split apart like a tangerine. And you just pop them in your mouth. And like I say, it's like a grapefruit flavored gumdrop without the bitter part of grapefruit. I have the Thai Long Kong variety. It's a really good one. It has fruited before. It's not a problem. But it is very cold sensitive and very wind sensitive.
What about a Santal?
They used to fruit here. They did a really good job. And now I can't even keep them alive. It's either the root knot nematodes or the Sri Lankan weevil. But I've got seeds coming tomorrow from Hawaii. I'm going to try one more time. I'll graft them next spring. If they die this time, I'm done with Santals.
My dentist has a big one about 14-inch diameter.
Get seeds. They should be on right now. Let's plant a bunch of rootstocks. Let's try one more time. Well, we got to wrap it up.
You bring
that
one in?
Yes, it's right back here.
Thank you. Welcome to, schedule to come down, bring the microphone.
Yes.